2 weeks ago, we had an incident at the museum when venomous glass butterflies escaped their enclosures. Last week, the first child visited the horrifying museum, setting off a cascade of horror. And, for the first time in 15 years, the museum's phone rang. This week, I found myself scrubbing away at the scatterbrained mirror in the paranormal wing of the museum. The premise was simple. The mirror's deep navy and galaxy sparkled reflection would read your eyes. And the deepest horrors and fears from the recesses of your mind would scatter onto the mirror like brain paint. If I'm being completely honest, I utterly dreaded cleaning the mirror. I hated seeing my daughter's distorted face, staring back at me, or the reanimated horrors of the museum, eating away at my flesh. Yes, I'm talking about you, Mariette. I peered my head out the large doorway, to the plastic doll in her display. My microfiber cloth polished the blood and muck from the corners of the mirror's golden ornamental frame. It reached between the crevices of the perched gargoyles it depicted in its etchings around the rim of its face. Around the center, I swirled and swirled until it was squeaky tidy. When I saw my daughter Sophia, I met her imaginary hand at the interface of the reflection with mine. When I saw monstrous exhibitions standing behind my shoulders, I rolled two unimpressed eyes. Cleaning carried my mind to the clouds, and I thought about the museum rather than the labor ahead of me. I guess there is a great fear in unknowing, and, like a disease, the fear I once had for the museum's daunting artifacts soon spread to another host once I became accustomed to its horrifying mechanisms while living in its belly for so long. The unpredictable fear and excitement of the building bit the wealthy visitors like a rabid dog, and my panic no longer grew from the museum's walls, but blossomed from the cruel, diseased hearts of the deplorable rich people that visited. I could always predict the way the museum would react, never the manner human malice could. And every week, I had no choice but to confront those who visited the museum and mold myself to their erratic and sickening behavior. It was the same fear that gripped me 15 years ago before I signed the employment contract. The fear I had in my 20s, the fear that came from finding out my daughter's cancer was untreatable without chemotherapy. We were young, and my job didn't pay enough for costly therapy. Hopelessness met me at the end of an empty whiskey bottle, which it stared at me accusingly until the very last drop. I was a failed father with nothing but time on his hands to watch my daughter, Sophia, wither away and observe her joyful, smiling soul fall through my fingers like sand. That was until the day I saw a strange article in the newspaper. "Tour guide wanted," it read. When I saw the salary listed, I saw not dollar signs, but my daughter's bright smile. My mind's eye witnessed her future graduation, her wedding, the second chance from the cruel illness that had been pulling her away from my arms and into a child-sized coffin. The employment contract to be the tour guide at the private museum was simple, yet unforgiving. The paycheck was huge, enough to solve my personal woes and help my family. Though, the paperwork was littered with strange clauses, most of which ended with, "In the event of breaching this agreement, employees subject to immediate termination and exsanguination." If you don't know what exsanguination means, it's a showy word to describe draining your circulation of blood. I was 20-something, desperate, and I had guessed the word meant that they were going to forcibly take me from the property. Later, when I found out what it meant, I consoled myself it was merely a sick joke. No organization simply murdered unruly employees. My wife, however, didn't find it amusing. Though, desperation took me. It propelled me to sign up for Sophia's sake. And the museum held me in its jaws for 15 years. The contract was indefinite, and early termination would result in one thing: exsanguination. This was no known organization. No one would hear me scream, not even God. And in this place, there was no God, only the rich and famous. Last week, when I picked up the phone, a voice, sprinkled with familiarity, met my ear. It was the voice of someone I had heard before, sounding deep and curdled between obese lips. It was the museum curator, and I had not spoken to him in 15 years, since the day he presented me with my contract. "Hi there, boyo," he boomed. A hissing of stubble sounded through the archaic museum phone. "Who is this?" I murmured. He bellowed a fat man's laugh. "Oh, you don't recall?" And my stomach sank when I remembered the curator's voice. We spoke for a while, and the conversation was short and terrifying. He was understanding, but beneath his bubbly tone, there was an underlying and unsated desire for cruelty. He was just like the rest. After a short chat, he coughed into the phone to break the catch-up. "What I'm trying to say, lad, is that I appreciate your commitment to the museum. That I do. That I do. For the guest list tonight," he paused, murmuring gibberish as he read something. "Yes, yes. 5 will be attending the function tonight, 4 of which are guests." I nodded to myself. I was off the hook. But why was he calling me? "Great, I'll..." "The last attendee is not a guest. Rather, we'll be there for your aforementioned exsanguination." I think my heart stopped. "Excuse me?" I said. "Oh, it's not all bad, chap. If the attendee is incapacitated and unable to carry out the clause of your contract, kill you. We'll be seeing you on time for work next week. Cheerio." The phone clicked off. It was a painful week after that night, and my heart never left my throat. Every waking moment, my mind would drift and be reminded that someone was coming to the museum to end me. I suppose that was always a risk when giving tours to the deplorable brats that visited. But this time was different. Whoever it was, their sole goal was to leave my body cold and lifeless. I checked my watch after I had finished polishing the mirror and began walking toward the enormous foyer. The uneasiness, as well as my turning stomach, almost made me forget it had to feed. Tooth fairy. Up the stairs I went, down the halls, passing the locked steel door on my way. I had never opened that door, and it always tickled my curiosity. Though, there was absolutely no way inside without a key. Besides, it was a matter for another time. The guests were going to arrive in 15 minutes. So was my executioner. At the end of the flowing walls of the music and art exhibition was a dimly lit doorway that I rarely entered. Outside, on a large gold placard above the entrance, "Tooth Fairy." The room inside was a dark cube space with painted black walls. A single spotlight illuminated the painting hung in the center of the furthest wall. A horrifying face of an anguished man was brushed across the canvas that looked like a hairless, burning corpse. Its mouth and eyes were vacant holes. Distant white specks could be made out in the open cavities of its face, teeth, throatfuls and eye sockets lined with hundreds of teeth. We were given this painting from a woman who saw the face move on her bedroom wall. Obviously, no art dealers would take her up on a donation. Our cleaners kept their teeth from our deceased visitors' corpses for a special reason. It's grotesque, sure, but completely necessary. From my maroon waistcoat pocket, I pulled a handful of bloody teeth and fit them snugly in the rim of the artwork's ornamental frame. Monthly feeding became a ritual, so we didn't leave the painting and walk the halls. I hated the times I forgot to feed him, the times he crawled out of the canvas dye and slogged around the halls, looking for me. I checked my watch. It was 5:59. The museum was about to open. Quickly adjusting my waistcoat and brushing my hair, I came tapping down the marble staircase of the vast foyer. With two hands, I pulled open the enormous door. As usual, the rich folks sauntered into the museum on their invisible high horses. My wandering eye scanned and assessed them quickly. Any one of them could be my undoing. In the group of five, there was two men, one plump and stubby, another gaunt and scraggly. Out of the three women, two were bony and frightening to look at, like fleshy scarecrows with long, pompous noses. Lastly was a lady that was quite pale and beautiful, her eyes quite small on her face, which was framed by ash black bangs and a ponytail. That woman, however, stood out to me long after we had begun the tour. The ponytail of hers didn't stick out from her rich girl high horse. Rather, her middle-class mannerism. She carried herself with pride that was of a hard-working businesswoman, content and happy with her 9-to-5. Not the accomplished grandeur of reeling in millions of dollars of fortune from multiple estates. Was this her? I took them through a couple exhibitions, passing the glass-walled hallways between our greenhouse where Holly had eaten a man the week before. They clapped the Venus flytrap's enormous olive mouth as it twisted under the evening starlight, oblivious to its horrific history. Though, maybe one of them knew. The one the curator had spoken to must have known everything. We had stopped at the paranormal wing. They saw Mariette for a while before their eyes, then set on something else. "What's under here?" a woman said, pulling at the display cabinet's blanket. "Take a look," I said, pulling the fabric away with one shaky hand like a magician terrified of a failing stunt. He had no human mouth, nor teeth. His snout was the long hairy tube appendage of a blowfly. You could see his black eyes in the incandescent light at certain angles. They had faded to pitch after the many years of anguish and isolation in his glass prison. His face was a charcoal black, not gray. So was his gangly body that broke out wings and spiny limbs through his hairy graphite flesh. There was no white in his eyes, only a screen door pattern upon two bulging, dark eyeballs that housed a thousand more. He watched us, unblinkingly, through the glass. One deformed wing buzzing and clicking, moving, half human, half fly. Below the display, on a golden placard, it read, "Beelzebub." The woman in a long brunette ponytail leaned in and gawked, pressing her done-up nails against the glass with a clack. as she turned her head to say, "Shouldn't he be in the insect exhibit, guide?" The thing inside the glass turned his revolting head too, as if it could understand her, as if he felt mocked. There were a couple chuckles from the rich crowd. My jaw tightened, though. They were upsetting him. He was there, originally, yes. I wiped one sweaty palm against my trousers. He was brought into the museum by an anonymous donor, describing it as being the product of experimental chemical warfare. The lady nodded, pensively. The thing buzzed inside the glass. "However," I continued, "our team quickly disproved this. Our museum was unable to understand what the creature was, nor what happened to him. And so, he rots his days away, stuck in the paranormal wing. It's tragic, but necessary. I personally believe the person who donated him thought we were his last resort to dispose of him." Suddenly, one hairy feeler braced the glass and stuck against the barrier like a sticky black hoof. I felt queasy and wanted to move on. But the questions kept pouring. "How did he get his name?" a man's voice said from the back. "In theology, Beelzebub was one of the seven princes of hell. In Ugaritic, the name roughly translates to Lord of the Flies." My eye briefly caught the thing in the display cabinet, bending its head to the side like a confused dog, one disgusting tube snout rocking back and forth like a pacifier. "Does it think? I mean, like you or I?" "We simply don't know," I said. "Not many staff come into this exhibition chamber, let alone try to interact with the pieces." Extending one arm forward, I ushered the crowd to walk on. We did for a while, until I noticed the woman with the black ponytail still pressed against the glass, gawking at the blowfly's body. "Ma'am?" She pointed an index finger at it for a couple of moments before speaking. "I want to try to speak to him. He looks like he's in pain." "I don't think that's a good idea." You probably pass him every day you work here," she interrupted, her tone searing me like hot coal. "Giving tours, cleaning cabinets, and not once have you tried to find out if he's still human in there." Her finger darted against the glass to his bulbous, hairy black head. I glared at her for a while and brooded. Did this museum guest have compassion? No. I swallowed. Was this her? The curator's inside woman? The one trying to kill me? If she got any closer to the fly, she would be as good as dead. Though, I might be the collateral damage. "We should move on," I asserted. She snorted. "No, I don't think we shall." The lady nodded her head towards the enclosure. "Open it. You are welcome to try to communicate with it through the glass." I wrapped my knuckles against the boundary. She stared at me with shark eyes. "With the glass, he's an animal. Without, he's equal. I want to speak to him as such." "Now open the damn cabinet," she boomed. I couldn't think straight anymore. The curator's game was plaguing me. This had to be her, right? She was going to let Beelzebub free and kill us. Still, I had a plan. My shaky hand gripped the master key and slowly fumbled it into the cabinet's lock. Inside, the abomination sucked its tube snout pacifier back and forth in excitement. Its thousands of eyes saw fresh meat. He was hungry. The woman reached her arm around and climbed into the cabinet with the creature, her expensive slippers skidding along the floor with a screech. She was talking brave before, but confronted with the towering, contorted thing ahead, The lighting painted her pale face a horrific grimace. At that moment, she knew she wanted to get out. The back of the woman still hung out past the cabinet's doorframe, in case she needed a quick exit. She didn't dare stand fully inside the fly's enclosure. And my heart was beating out of my chest. She was gonna let him out, and Beelzebub shall suck my flesh through his face straw like a human strawberry milkshake. Breathing was hard. I felt like I was gonna pass out. Without warning, I kicked the woman forward. My foot planted itself on her back and she went tumbling into the enclosure and against the far end of the glass, screaming, screaming. I shut and locked the door swiftly. The curator will not have my head this evening. I found her. She's the one who wants me dead. "Help me," she screamed. Gasps of the crowd behind me sounded like they were wheezing into balloons. I leaned one hand against the door. "You wanted to speak to him face to face." The abomination was reanimated. Spiny insectoid hooks spread from its hairy half-human flesh. It spread and beat its ghoulish torn wings. It was ready to feast.
"What the hell are you doing?" one of the men behind shouted.
And I turned my head to him, complying. Suddenly, the woman's drumming fists did something frail insect's hooves never could. She smashed a hole in the cabinet from the inside and came tumbling out onto the floor in a cascade of glass. One of the pompous rich men laughed. He turned to run, but the buzzing monstrosity caught him. From its glass prison, it spurted from its mouth tube. Slime covered the man's face, like sage jelly, dotted with smaller black blowflies. It was something like out of my nightmares of Sophia. The blowflies bored holes into his flesh, into his cheeks. Crawling didn't get him far. The flies were already digging, digging. He screamed and the rest of the guests screamed too. Flies buried under his cheeks and came crawling out through the corners of his eyes. Red gaping holes emerged beneath the skin that popped like peach-colored balloons, filled with bloody paint. The flies were even inside his gums, and the man screamed. He screamed and screamed until the screams were no more. Until it was just me alone beside his corpse, with the flies that crawled and squirmed inside his spiny flesh suit. On my knees, I vomited against the marble wall, my hand meeting his pool of life fluid on the floor. Exsanguinated, Beelzebub's mouth tube met one of the man's calves and sucked chunks of his fleshy soup up with a thirp like Satan's vacuum cleaner. From crawling to standing, I broke into a sprint, managing to steady by dragging my hand against the marble as I ran, leaving trails of bloody finger-painted lines. A grotesque artwork only the Tooth Fairy could appreciate. My feet skidded around the ground as I bolted around corners, past the living wall and deep sea exhibition. At the end of one hallway, my eye caught her ponytail that darted into the museum's theater. She was up to something. Her plan failed. Now she was finding something else to kill me. Inside the theater was vast and ornate, with rows upon rows of silky lilac seats. Marble balconies reached out over the stage, like great, expensive white clouds. Small halls projected streams of light from the theater's corners, ceiling, and stage. A brilliantly blue humpback whale, suspended in shifting light, floated from the entrance beside me. Downhill the slope of seats, before blubbering and disappearing into the walls as the projectors flickered. Specks of light from its shooting spout had hit my face like droplets of rain, and felt like cold fingers against my cheek. For a short lifespan, our theater and its holograms were real.
the brunette woman, didn't know that. Though, she was my executioner. Maybe she did. I slowly stepped down the staircase. She was shaking, screaming at me from the stage, her voice echoing in the enormous decorative room. Get away from me! I stepped closer and closer, and she didn't stop screaming. You locked me in the cabinet with... As she trailed off, the lights dimmed to pitch black. The next show was about to commence. Trumpets suddenly boomed and shook the theater. Spotlights illuminated a single holographic soldier, cleaning his rifle to the right of the stage. The next showing was a war performance I had seen many times before. My heart was beating in my chest. The fly was searching the halls for more food. And we were the closest feast. I was pleading for us to leave at the top of my lungs, over the loud roaring trumpets, barely hearing my own voice. The woman backed away, tears streaming down her face and distorting her mascara. As if possessed by the museum, the soldier finished cleaning his gun, turned, and gave me a sickening grin. White light flickered a show of revoltingly sharp teeth as he loaded his rifle. And I had watched this presentation hundreds of times, and this was a first. I screamed. The trumpets boomed and boomed. She kept walking backwards, away from me, and into the soldier's line of fire. My mouth was agape. My shriek rumbled my lungs with reverb, my soundless voice tearing away at my coarse throat. The holographic bullet tore a hole through her skull, a hammer meeting fleshy coconut. Bits of blood and brain painted chickenpox specks of death upon my maroon waistcoat. And the projected soldier showed teeth. I thought back to the mirror I had cleaned earlier. Scatterbrain. Animated, the museum's horrifying specter slowly bent to one knee and began loading his rifle with the next non-existent bullet. I tumbled over seats and stairs as I sprinted from the stage toward the entrance. Holes tearing away at the lilac fabric of the chairs as he shot, opening flaps like blooming verbena flowers. I might have thrown up again if I didn't have to keep running. Beelzebub slogged behind me, distant at the end of the hallway, his spiny hooked feet screeching against the marble. Buzzing mocked me from behind as a deformed wing that was never meant to fly twitched in the starlight that fluttered over his hairy thorax. Guests were still screaming in the foyer. They darted in every angle like shaken rats. My hand reached for the museum's front door. My lady executioner was dead, but my eyes were traumatized with gore. I couldn't bear it anymore. I reached to pull the door open and the museum's phone rang. Once again, my heart felt like it stopped beating. I let go of my shaky grip around the cold door handle. Up the stairs I went, wiping one sweaty hand against my trouser leg. Reluctantly, I reached for the phone. Hello? My quiet voice fell out of my mouth. Oh, guide. The sound of the plump curator pulling from his cigarette. Your debt in punishment has been paid. None of tonight's guests were anything special. I swallowed sour spit. My throat was tight. What do you mean? They're middle-class volunteers on a luxury-sponsored trip to a private museum. None were there for the exsanguination. And boy, oh, did you prove that you belong here or what? I slammed the phone on my reception desk, the sound of plastic echoing throughout the foyer and ringing in my ears.
A cold feeling flooded my chest. My horrible realization dismantled me. This week, the guests never did anything particularly dreadful. It was me alone who had cornered them into hell from fear of losing my own life. My punishment from the curator was never death. It was torment. Was I a monster too? For a while, I cried in the foyer, oblivious to the screaming and carnage unfolding throughout the museum. Tears flowed down my face and stained paperwork of dead guests. My hands still shaking from fear and dread from the museum's looming and reanimated monstrosities. Beelzebub was coming. I didn't like what I was becoming. I was gonna leave this dreadful museum. No matter the price. I received a terrible punishment from the museum's curator that left me with a lasting burning bitterness. There were two unopened doors at the museum that had always haunted me since I started. The first being the locked steel door I had passed countless times at the museum, yet remained locked and never accessible. A peculiar haunting that amounted from itching curiosity. It had been swimming around in my head since that young girl visited the museum a few weeks ago, and her curiosity prodded away at its potential. Secondly, and more horrifyingly, was the shut doorway to Johnny Razortongue's display. The only exhibition I never entered out of unadulterated fear. Johnny Razortongue is to blame is why Mariette, the previous guide, the one that walked the museum's halls before me, went mad. It has been said that his plastic ventriloquist dummy tongue only speaks in mind-shattering truths, or lethal lies. He chooses either truth or lie, based on whatever brings him the most entertainment at the time from his deprived, sealed exhibition cell, in the corner of our paranormal wing. His disturbed mind knows only disarray, and it thrives in all manners of consequences from his cruelty. Mariette knew this all too well. The dummy poured pestilence into her ear from the moment she visited him, contorting and twisting her once fortified mind like molten glass under his heated will. And so, Mariette's ill-fated psyche bent. It bent and bent until Mariette was no more. Until all that remained of the old guide was her doll-like shell. After she gave in to Johnny Razortongue. After she believed his lies. After she injected herself with plastic to become a ventriloquist dummy. Just like him. After she decided to please the museum and to please Johnny. Nothing remained but her tortured soul inside of her plasticized and reanimated body. It was snowing the day I decided to leave the museum. My hand braced the cold windowpane iced with white clumps, and the warmth sucked out of my hand easily like cigarette smoke. Years prior, when I started as the museum's tour guide, I received word that my daughter's cancer had taken her. A letter. That's all I was given by the oncology ward. The hospital informed me that my daughter had passed away by mail, which meant she had been dead for a few days before the paperwork actually arrived. The fact of that shattered me. I decided I would rather live with the burden of insanity before carrying on this cruel world with the burden of a dying child. Thinking back, it had been snowing that day too. Before deciding to venture into Johnny's exhibit to let his toxic words take me, just as he had Mariette,
The snow outside reminded me of holding her gloved hand at wintertime shows, and her face in my mind's eye begged me to keep living. I didn't visit him that day. Though, until recently, I felt no obligation to ever try to break my contract and leave the museum anymore. Sophia, my world, my darling, was dead. Why would I ever leave? I could stay and hold the ghastly hand of a ghoulish reflection against the interface of our museum's horrifying haunted mirrors. Here, Sophia was with me, and I was never alone. Stopping to gaze up at the enormous foyer, I was reminded that I too was an anguished exhibition in this rich man's contraption. The poor guy to push and pull it. The man who survived 15 years of torment. Look at his hollow eyes, the wealthy visitors probably thought. Look how dead inside he looks. No more misery. My daughter wouldn't want me to wither away like this. A pawn at the hand of the rich and famous. It was going to be freedom or death. On my way to visit Johnny, I found myself walking past the locked steel door, past the arts and music exhibition, and downstairs, next to the living wall and into the paranormal exhibition, when something caught my eye. It was Mariette, the reanimated plastic shell of the previous guide, in her display. She clicked her pale joints stiffly and fluttered her heavy eyelids against the tough friction. She was deceased and on show, but her soul was still very much alive. A soul that pushed her hand up and against her glass prison as if to say, "Stop, guide. Look what Johnny did to me and what he is going to do to you." "I'm sorry, Mariette," I thought. "Believe it or not, Johnny is going to help me leave this horrible place." I was so focused on organizing my plan to see the dummy and to leave the museum, I had almost forgotten to feed Ernie. I could never forget about Ernie. Beyond the insect exhibition hallway and to the left was our animals and evolution room. It was quite frankly rather dull, but Ernie always stood out to me like a hairy clawed thumb. I found myself walking swiftly through the marble halls, climbing upon the balcony that stretched above the open plan exhibition room. From the balcony overlooking his iron barred pen, I tossed him heads of purple and green lettuce, which he chomped with an effortless wet crunch. See, Ernie was a bear-sized mole, and he had a secret. He was a gentle giant, and I loved him. It was so difficult to find a kind soul in this abominable place. And so, I kept his secret. I found the hole he had dug through to the museum's garden, and I let him have it. He could have his freedom if I couldn't. Completely dreading it, I took my time on the way back to the paranormal wing. Visiting Johnny was a necessary evil. The plan was based around the belief that I was well adjusted enough to figure out if Johnny was telling me the truth or a lie, and adjust my plan to leave the museum accordingly with new information. If he lied, I would in turn unveil it, flipping his lie on its head and use the opposite. A truth to my advantage. 15 years of experience as the tour guide was behind my back. Something Mariette never had when his words broke her down. Becoming accustomed to the museum's horrors had made my mind a steel fortress. Though, I just hoped Johnny couldn't melt my mind as easily as he did Mariette's. My master key met the rustic, untouched lock and twisted with a clank. With one slow, reluctant pull, I opened the door to the ventriloquist doll's chamber for the first and hopefully last time. It was foolish of me to assume the lights would still turn on after 15 years. I turned to grab the torch from my hip, my eye catching Mariette a few meters behind me in her display, facing away in disgust from the room which had been her demise years ago. I swallowed tightly and smacked my flashlight alive against my palm. Johnny was sitting on a black stool in the center of the small room. The light from my torch lit up his pale skin, which contrasted against his baby-sized tuxedo. From the corners of his lips, straight downward to his chin, were thick red lines, cutting into his plastic face, forming a mouth. His voice was croaky, yet dripping in sickening enthusiasm. "Hiya, Michael." His words had already broken me. I hadn't heard that name in years, a decade even. I was lucky to even remember it. After a while, my name simply became Guide. But how? How could he? Buddy, pal. His eyes wandered loosely in his sockets, left then right, like rolling marbles as he spoke. How's it hanging, Mikey? There was no dust on his combed hair nor suit, as you would expect for an animated plastic horror, who kept tidy by wandering the confines of his room. His mouth was ever smiling as he leaned to one side. How's my girl? His stiff dummy frame moved and peered at Mariette over my shoulder behind me. Oh, isn't she just gorgeous now, Mikey? Look at that plastic shine. This thing was revolting, I thought. And? Johnny turned his stiff head to me, smirking under the bright torchlight. How's your girl? Dead in a hole, Mikey? My stomach plummeted. I would have torn his tiny, disgusting head off in an instant if I didn't need him. The puppet laughed with a menacing whine. Sophia, she rotting in the dirt? My fist clenched, and the spotlight from my torch shook over him like the light from a swinging chandelier. Maggots probably crawling out of her cheeks, eh, Mikey? Stop. I suddenly bursted out, my echo carrying for a while through the empty halls of the museum. For a while, he sat quietly on the stool, his legs freely kicking in the air like a kid sitting on the edge of a pier. He stared up at me with horrifying glassy eyes and a devilish smile that never quit. I'm leaving the museum for good at 6 o'clock, I gulped, watching his every move for hints of the truth or lie response that was about to come out of his plastic mouth. What do you think about that, Johnny? His head suddenly spun around several times as he spoke. Wow-wee, friendo. I have lots to think about. I do. For a while, I watched his puppet eyes roll around and show only white. He was contemplating, of sorts. You won't find any freedom outside, Mikey. His mouth pulled open mechanically and clasped shut as he spoke. Though, you will only find freedom. One tiny alarm beckoned me to lean closer, and I did. He was whispering when he spoke. Through the steel door. What? He leaned back on his stool, one plastic square chin dancing in the light as he laughed to himself. Now, I thought about it for a while. That steel door had remained sealed since I had started this awful job. He kept chuckling to himself before abruptly going quiet. His eyes were locked on the old guide behind me. Oh, Mariette. He called out a childish croak. I slammed the door shut and locked the door. Outside the room's tense atmosphere, I felt like I could breathe again. If only I could have gotten more information out of Johnny than a simple, straightforward lie. To avoid the lie of entering the steel door would be no drama. All I would have to do is run from the museum, as I always thought I would have to do. When I checked my watch, I saw it was 5 minutes to 6. I came bolting around into the enormous foyer. The guests would be arriving in a matter of minutes. The towering, ornate museum door opened with its usual mechanical groan. I pushed past a man with a salt and pepper beard, his blustering coat nearly catching my face in the cold wind. Lady Weather was against me this evening, but the plan was already in motion. The plan was to run. I almost tumbled when one of the rich pricks smacked me by my arm as I jogged down the stairs. I couldn't exactly hear what he said. The swirling breeze swam in my eardrums like a cold stream. A sound that I didn't often hear from inside the rich man's prison. It was beautiful. Every step into the museum's wide frozen garden made a gentle hush beneath my shoe in the soft snow. I couldn't look back until I met the tree line. When I did, I noticed a few of the men that gave chase. I launched through the spiny bushes ahead, taking exaggerated steps over rough terrain like a horse that walked with a proud gallop. Cuts and scratches against my flesh from branches felt liberating. It was painful, but it was not the museum's contraptions hurting me anymore. It was the fresh lashes of wild, unpredictable freedom. I'm almost free, Sophia. I could feel the warmth of my daughter smiling down on me. She wants me to be free. Guide. The deep voice of one of my pursuers boomed through the forest with reverb, and my heart spiked in my wheezing chest. They were closing in. Though, why were they after me? I had left the door wide open for them. Turn around and burn the museum down, you horrible bastards. There was no doubt in my mind that if I stopped, one of the rich brutes would bash the brain juice out of my skull with a sharp rock. How dare I, the suffering guide, threaten the fun of the wealthy expedition and take off into the woods? Quick, clapping and crunching of bark behind me made my ears prick. Without warning, one red silk shoulder of my waistcoat was snagged in an angry bald fist before I was yanked backward, making me tumble into the mud and muck. I pulled my head up with a groan, my joints aching dully and skin searing like a full-body carpet burn. The museum guest straddling my chest was a mere silhouette, the backdrop of stars behind his head, only lighting graying hair up at the edges. His cold fingers met my throat, tightening and tightening. Wriggling left and right was hard with legs against my chest. Clumps of snow fell gently onto my face in bites of cold as his hands crushed my neck. I swung and swung at his kidney with my fist, but he didn't let up. The stars above became a blur, and the top of his head filled the bottom of my vision. One of my keys I had clenched between my knuckles punctured its side, and he went rolling down a snowy bank. Gripping my purple bruised throat, I stumbled forward, but wheezing meant I wasn't getting enough air to keep up a jog. "Stop," his voice called. With each step, the snow had seemingly gotten thicker, though it still gave way to my feet with the same distinct hush. I couldn't let up, not when I was this close. Yonder the snowy bank in front of me was a large building I had never seen before. It was quite smaller than the museum. Bigger than the off-site cottage I slept in during my days off, a warehouse. It didn't take long to limp to it and break inside. The smell of rotten wood and mold inside the warehouse crawled up my nose
like invisible, pungent fingers. Bars of starlight came through the boarded windows, covering the walls and floor in crooked glowing streaks of the moon's azure silver gleam. It was dusty, unkempt, dry. Grimy particles coated and tickled my throat. The dust in the building was so awful that my cough might have looked like billowing steam. Silhouettes of all shapes and sizes lined the walls and shelves, most with flaps of paper attached to them. It was a haven for retired exhibitions. That, or their hell. Thudding came from behind me as someone pushed and pulled at the door, trying to follow me inside. Unsettled flakes of crumbling wood drifted down from the ceiling with every shake from the banging door. My departed Sophia's face suddenly glowed on the black canvas of my tight eyelids. "I think I'll be seeing you soon, darling." I stumbled forward, coughing and glaring around the murky warehouse as the thuds became impatient. I needed something to get me out of here. Anything. "Where you think you're going?" A man's muffled voice boomed from under the door. It was the same man who had gripped me by my throat minutes prior. His tone was strained and fed up. I pictured his face flush and the cables of his neck sticking out as thick roots. My cold digits wrapped around one of the planks sealing the window, boarded shut. My options of fight or flight narrowed to the latter. Thud. The door was stubbing shut against something, but not for much longer. One of the lines of light pouring inside the dingy space sparkled upon something a few feet away, made out of glass. I walked closer. Each step, the floorboard spat out a dying croak. When I was near enough to make out what the thing was, a cold feeling bloomed in my stomach. The thing I approached, in the blanketing dim starlight, was animatronic and ghoulish. Clumps of its brown artificial and fraying fur were clumped together in sticky balls of black grease. Its glass tennis ball eyes held tiny, startling black pinhole-sized pupils. It was a human-sized depiction of a vintage stuffed monkey holding brass cymbals. Stuffing had come away from its middle in spongy yellow bunches, exposing rusty metal gears within the mechanical chest. I tried not to make eye contact with it, out of fear of it following my gaze. I still had to think quickly about defending myself. The door hadn't stopped thudding. Messily, stuck to one furry ear of the mechanical being, were a few pages of forms, faded and dusty. I puffed away dirt from the paper with one labored wheeze. It read, "Exhibition name, Kelsey. Children's mechanical mascot that once educated schools about the importance of healthy teeth and gums." I hadn't noticed it until now. Large and eerily human-shaped teeth stuck out from the monkey's fur lips. An animatronic monkey to tell your kids to brush their teeth, of course. Out of commission, 1983. Reason, excessive homicidal tendencies. Signed and approved, Mariette. Mariette and I, connected by threads of time after all these years. This must have been an especially terrifying item to warrant locking it up in a warehouse to rot. I couldn't believe that I had found something retired by the previous tour guide of the museum. It made me feel less alone. I hadn't felt that flavor of deep-chested and rotten fear in over a decade. A time when I was unacquainted with what lurked around the museum's ornate corners. However, this evening, I was again in unfamiliar and petrifying territory. Why was I not informed of this place? I would have decommissioned Johnny Razortongue in a heartbeat. If not for me, then for Mariette's tortured soul. Without warning,
the stuffed mechanical abomination switched on. It chilled my blood to see golden iridescent bulbs flickering in the place where its lifeless, beady globes had been. Its jaws gnashed wildly, lagging and biting. It was stuck in a loop for a while, seeing through eyes that hadn't seen the world in decades as it woke from its slumber. It turned to me, gleaming gears and yellow eyes all feasting on the one who broke its sleep. Me. Kel. The speaker tried to sing in a child's voice, but the rusty electronics could only cough up distorted noise. When it finally started to tune and began walking, I made for the door. Kelsey Yum, drink milk for bones, put it in your tum. My hand met the handle of the door. I went tumbling backward as the man kicked it in first. My elbow collapsing into one rotten floorboard. The mechanism behind me sang, and her cymbals crashed. Bones, strong teeth for bite. No moans. Brush your teeth at night. The intruder's hand was immediately aiming for my throat once more, but I was faster. I turned quickly, catching one of his arms and pulling them behind his back in a lock. Twisting, I faced his kicking leg outward at Kelsey. The cymbal clapping animatronic monstrosity approaching slowly, gears churning in its open chest. Crash went the cymbals. They crashed until the gears caught both of his boots in its exposed core as he tried to kick her away. But he was locked in my arms, and he was locked tight. From then, it took a while for the man to stop screaming. His feet met the unyielding gears of animatronic innards in a red cloud of skin and bone. Calcium, drink milk for bones, put it in your tum. The once childlike voice coming out of the thing's speaker became choppy and deep-pitched, like a singing birthday card with a dying battery. At the moment, I could only hope my daughter wasn't looking down, watching me ghoulishly smile as my rich pursuer struggled and screamed in my locked arms. Close your eyes if you're watching, honey. Daddy is going to be free soon. The man screamed and screamed, and the dying speaker's voice line sung. Calcium. Metal gears were up to his calves. His cartilage popped. His leg bones buckled and broke with a stomach-curdling crack as Kelsey snapped his femurs like thick white pencils through her gears, as if the man was fleshy mulch. I only let go when he finally became limp. His screams were no longer. All that could be heard in the dusty room was the mechanical spinning and clunking of gears from the animated monstrosity to my side. For a while, I sat in the dark as it ate him whole. It felt good to finally fight back, but it was never meant to feel this good. The sound of his bones crunching, the sound of his voice extinguishing like a wet flame. I was no longer going to be the one being tortured and tormented. I was going to be free. Though, as the age-old saying goes, ignorance is bliss. I wish I hadn't looked down at the mutilated man. I wish I hadn't seen that he was not someone wealthy, nor a guest after all. Catching a proper glance at him, in the dim moonlight shining over his overalls and glistening keys, it became terrifyingly evident that he was museum security. I killed a man that was just trying to do his job. No, I didn't. I didn't. The museum did. Deep down, I think I knew I was responsible, though, and that I might have enjoyed watching it happen. But it was time to keep moving. I swiftly bent down and swooped a metallic lighter and a ring of many keys before leaving the stuffed horror alone to eat. Most of the keys were long and identical to mine, from the looks of things. Snow was blowing outside the warehouse. I had to squint freezing ice peppered eyes to see and orientate myself away from the museum's grounds. For a while, I walked aimlessly in the blistering snow, not seeking a goal, but salvation, in as much distance I could make between the museum and myself. The weather was relentless, as I was ill-equipped from the get-go. At some point, I had a call with the museum's curator as I stumbled around the barren icy wilderness. But reality bordered with delusion.
"You can never leave the museum, Michael." A voice was buzzing through the speaker. "You two are entwined."
My jaw was chattering. I watched the steam from my mouth and lips escape me.
"This money," the curator continued. "The type of money to let you run something like this. Your contract simply does not end if you leave our borders, Sonny. You should know this."
He was speaking in a condescending tone. All I could hear for a while was the clinking of a lighter opening and the curator sucking through a cigarette over the phone. Occasionally, the wind blew a strong gust and pulled away my coat.
"I think it's time you expire, boyo. See, we even have a new guide lined up to replace you. It's over." "I'm gonna be free."
My voice was slow and hard to hear over chattering teeth. The curator scoffed.
"No, Michael, you're not. And I want to thank you for letting those people that are lonely at the top of the financial mountain, those rich and famous who are under constant judgmental eyes, those akin to exhibitions in the museum, letting them truly be somewhere and be someone when they are not themselves. At our museum, they can be the audience, not the newspapers, nor the public's exhibitions. And you were instrumental in such success."
Breathing didn't come easy. The air swirled and chilled my lungs like inhaling menthol. "I'm going to be free." Words were labored from my lips.
"Farewell, Michael."
The phone clicked off. I staggered for a while after the call had ended. Hypothermic brain fog had me going in every which way. I had no chance of making it back to the museum in such delirium. Did I want to return, however? No, of course not. It was cold, and I was tired. I laid down in a pile of snow under a naked tree. The evening's snowy breeze no longer felt like anything at all across my numb face. Just for a little while. I'll sleep in the cold for a little while. I tilted my head back, letting my eyelids drift shut, and the stars above sing me a final lullaby. For a while, the constellations looked like my daughter's face, and I smiled. If I held a handful of snow tight enough, it didn't feel like I was dying alone. I felt like someone was holding my hand, and the fear started to blow away with the wind. But the snow in my hand was hairy, and it was warm, and it was breathing. A cold pile beneath my arm erupted into the air with a snort, as if from a whale spout. His brown fur looked unworldly against the field of snow. He couldn't see much with his two black beady eyes beyond his whiskers, but he knew it was me. And I knew it was him. Ernie. I swiftly buried into the thick layer of concave snow that Ernie's pink and brown head came from. It was hard to see anything inside the hole, if at all, but it was a lot warmer than the surface. Inside, the lighter I had pulled from the security guard no longer faltered in any wind in the tight space, and I caught the tail end of the mole's pink hind paws and the lighter's soft glow as he began to scurry back through the tunnel toward the museum. I crouched to slog through the tunnel using only the lighter and Ernie to guide me. Warmth returned to my extremities and spread in waves. Come to think of it, the lighter was not the only thing I had found on the man's body. Upon the key ring I had taken was a peculiar long and winding key I had never seen before. One that I never owned. A key to a steel door. I was spitting out specks of dirt by the time I made it back to the museum through Ernie's tunnel. An earthy taste coated my tongue and throat. Soil stuck to my grazed eyebrows. When I finally emerged in the evening light that came through the windows of the building, Ernie's snub nose was sniffing and snorting as I pat him on his furry brown head. Pompous, cackling, beckoned me from the hallway. The type of egotistical rich laughter that came from throwing a heavy, inflated head back. Wiping muck away from the face of my watch, I saw it was already 9 o'clock. The deplorable guests had already been roaming the museum for 3 hours. I didn't want to ponder what unimaginable damage they had done. I was about to leave through the doorway of the Animals and Evolution exhibition for the foyer and make my way towards the sealed door. But when it suddenly began, my heart felt as if it had stopped. One after another, the display cabinets throughout the museum that once held the imprisoned exhibitions exploded into clouds of broken shards. Shattering bangs echoed down the hallway. The floors above me, the greenhouse. It was a symphony of broken glass clattering throughout the entire building in bursting pops. A cacophony of impending frenzy. The air inside the museum was tense, scalding. Me, its tour guide, the eyes and ears of the place, was trying to leave for good. And the building exploded in a hot, retaliating rage. The museum abhorred me for attempting an escape, and the exhibitions were let free. From the halls, the once cackling guests soon found quiet and confusion. And silence swiftly grew screams as delirium blossomed into blind fear. Glass displays still distantly popped and met the marble like clattering hail. It occurred to me, in that moment of sharp terror, that the museum itself was an exhibition in of itself. A wealthy man's Pandora's box. And staring around at the violent exploding glass that had housed our precious artifacts, her message was hauntingly clear. If she couldn't have me, then no one else could. Two men frantically bolted into the room, running from an unseen horror. Their faces were polar opposite expressions. One spoke volumes of fear under a furrowed brow. The other had a jaw that was tightened with invisible bolts of disdain. Mr. Frightened and Mr. Angry. A rigid dichotomy which showed their contrasting feelings in the face of death. Here, in this abominable rich man's graveyard, they knew they were going to die. And to hear the museum narrow their death sentence with every pop of distant glass felt intensely euphoric. What's going on? Mr. Frighten's voice was a helpless drone. Where were you? I held my breath. From their demeanor beginning to calm
it was evident that they felt relatively at ease in the seemingly dull animal wing of the museum. I would have felt the same if my eye didn't catch the finger-length chameleon crawling up Mr. Angry's wrist. The other man caught wind of what I was looking at. He looked down at Mr. Angry's forearm, and his bulging eyes looked like they could have fallen out of his head. "Oh, God," the man with the chameleon up his elbow said. "I've read about these on the placard. How did it get..." His voice was shaking. I wiped one sweaty hand on my leg and began to back away. This, all of this didn't concern me. I had to escape the museum. I had to find out what was behind the steel door. "It's gonna bite me, right? It's venomous, right, guide?" Mr. Angry shrieked. "Get it the hell off of me." I interjected, stepping one foot back, then the next. "No, though it." Without warning, the man peeled it from his skin, one thumb pushing against Chameleon's neck to expose fangs. Mr. Angry swiped the reptile at the other man with force, and its mouth stuck to his skin like a dartboard, and he laughed. "The rich and famous that visited here were never gonna change," I thought. Watching Mr. Frightened squirm and all the blood that slowly drizzled from the freshly carved holes in his neck. Never. The bitten man looked like a chameleon for a while. At least, part of him did. His wounded neck skin bloomed orange, violet. Scaly flesh beneath his jaw was iridescent in the moonlight. Human cells were never meant for camouflage, and the man was soon a testament to that. Mr. Frightened didn't make a sound. Only an anguished grimace in his pain as his skin cells flowered sage. Then, ocean blue. The pain was clearly insufferable. Enough to turn him mad. Enough to want to spoon the bloodshot eyes out of their sockets. Though the worst stomach-curdling process was yet to come. There was never venom, though the chameleon's bite was turning his skin. When his human shell could bear the stress of the chameleon evolution no longer, the blotches of scales that his flesh had morphed into soon became clear as glass. Transparent areas of the man's skin bloomed in circles, growing slowly and easily like puddles in rain. He went to grab a banister with one coolish crystalline hand, but he couldn't have known that the chameleon's contagious, clear pigmentation would also make his flesh as thin as paper. Pointy finger bones tore through the tips of his fragile paper skin, like spiny white staples, as his hand touched the wood. And he screamed and screamed. Mr. Frightened fell to one knee, the only limb that showed the true color of his flesh. As he toppled over, I saw his liver, his heart. All organs and gore were on show as I stared through his back that looked like a mere translucent veil or a jellyfish. The chameleon's contagious pigment miraculously started to spread to his neck bones and his skull, and his skin and bones bloomed as clear as a window. No sound came out of his mouth when he screamed then. Only that sickening tear that came after his brittle see-through neck snapped under the weight of his brain. His head made a splash as it dived from his shoulders onto the marble floor. Watching his facial skin flake away into translucent dust, I was reminded of the venomous glass butterflies we housed in our insect exhibition. I wouldn't be surprised if this is how they originally came into being. There was a brief, satisfying respite after I watched the rich man meet his demise. When my heart and standing hairs upon two shaking arms settled, I recalled how vulnerable he had looked with his organs showing. How scared he must have felt in the moment before his head broke loose from his body. His memories his hopes and fears, his rich ego all ending in an instant,
as his fleshy mind bubble met marble.
How gratifying. The other man tore me out of my moment of ecstasy, as if he had plunged me in a freezing bath. Mr. Angry was wildly swinging a hammer in front of me. It narrowly missed the bridge of my nose.
We're completely fucked because of you.
His voice lashed me with a searing culpability. He swung again and missed because, that time, I was already on the move. I bolted for the door, my feet skidding as I turned in the hallway towards the foyer. Angry guests, exploding cabinets. It's all too much, Sophia, I thought. I know you're watching me, honey. I'm gonna be free. I reluctantly passed the steel door as I swiftly climbed the grand staircase in the foyer. I was gonna open it this evening to find freedom, just as Johnny told me I would. But not until I could shake the angry, wealthy prick off my tail. The floor inside the arts and music exhibition was littered with shattered glass of the displays of free exhibitions. And when I entered the room, I immediately went straight for the back wall. Above me, on a golden placard, the Tooth Fairy. Mr. Angry followed me into the dimly lit space, wielding his hammer tightly over one shoulder.
Nowhere to run, guide.
The man turned left, then right.
No reanimated freaks left here to do your bidding either, eh?
His eyes scanned the floors for smashed glass. The remains of any escape displays. But the Tooth Fairy didn't do my bidding. And it didn't need broken glass to be set free. Only the deep, nauseating hunger that rumbled within its canvas belly for the guest's mouth bones was needed for it to wake it from its die. An ash-colored hand tore out of the painting beside me, slowly reaching, wanting. Strings of oil pigment, like bloody tree sap or syrup, hung from its arms and neck as it hoisted itself out of the canvas. Its face had no eyes. Its head was only half of that. Only the jaw, mouth, and cheeks remained below its jagged outline of a missing scalp. The man turned, but the Tooth Fairy's fingers were long, and its famine even longer. It leaped from the canvas, pinning him tightly against the ground. His hand was limp, the hammer slipped from his grip. My heart was racing, skin goose flesh, but watching the animated painting pull the man's teeth felt intoxicating. There was a vile amusement that burned within. As I counted the number of teeth the ghoul had to unroot before the man's words became a wet, indiscernible mess. 6, 7. When there were no teeth left, it started at his lips. Pink leeches that peeled away, syrup strings and nerves. Hell me. Lease, the man gurgled. I smiled back, because the tortured tour guide that I once was proved to be no salvation for him. Perhaps only dentures were. And so, I picked up his hammer and left him there to expire. The museum foyer outside was as it always was, ornate and grand. I looked up at the mosaic ceiling and laughed as I walked down the stairs of her belly. An orchestra of exploding glass displays and screams drowning the sound of my chuckle like a loud, swirling drain of disarray. The horrifying museum for the rich and famous was absurd. And it ate me whole. I had the key to the steel door, and with it, my misery would come to an end. I can feel you smiling too, Sophia. Dad is leaving. The hallway wasn't very far,
The steel door wasn't far. Not much longer, Sophia. You're gonna be so proud of me. My stomach sank. I didn't anticipate the museum's curator to be situated outside the metal door. Two stumpy legs beneath him that looked as if they hardly held up his grape-like frame, which busted at the seams. "Michael," he said sternly, his back almost flat against the cold metal barrier behind him, "please don't do this." The head of the metal hammer in my hand shined brightly at the right angle. I walked toward the curator and the door. "Oh, boyo," the curator said. "You've gone mad. That grin." He shook his head. "The museum has gripped you, hasn't it?" My fingers reached up and patted my lips like they were going numb. Oh God, how long had I been smiling for? How long? "If you turn and leave," his thick voice was shaky, "we won't come after you. You have a choice, Mike." I contemplated for a while. Cold from the snow outside came through the broken foyer windows and chilled my bones. And I watched the steam of my breath rise from my lips. "Retire. Be free. Live what years you have left. Or enter the door, and you will never leave. It'll break you, boyo. It'll break her." He was holding his hands up submissively. "Please, Michael, do you want to leave?" I wanted to reply. I wanted to say yes. But the museum held my tongue, my arm. And the hammer swung and swung. Each blow was half Michael, half museum. But all of it. Every cracking of his skull, every slosh of the curator's brain under my hammer, was the bite of 15 years of torment. It was surprisingly easy to turn his skull into broken shards of bone in a gurgling fountain. Blood ran freely onto the ornate white floor like long, branching worms. In the poorly lit grayscale blanket of the evening, the curator's life fluid stood out vividly as a red pool against surrounding dull-washed colors. My breath was labored through smiling teeth that were speckled with red paint. "He's dead. He's really dead." It took a while for me to catch my breath. But when I finally did, I fumbled around for the key in my pocket and found that it slid into the steel door with ease. Surprising ease. As if the door had been open regularly. But it couldn't have been. I was here once a week and it was always locked tight. The steel door groaned open. Circular lights adorned the short metal hallway in rows, leading to a second wooden door a few steps away. Above the door, a golden placard. It read, "The next." My stomach plummeted. In bold letters, "The next guide." I reluctantly brought myself toward the second door and pulled. If I had been wearing a smile again, it was soon gone. Pink wallpaper plastered the walls inside the space and peeled off occasionally in curled rips. Save for one wall that was well kept. Most likely because it was decorated with Polaroid photos. The shelves were littered with teddy bears, the ground with clothes, the ceiling with fairy lights. I moved to the wall with the images and braced it with one hand as I peered closer. As I picked up one of the pictures, I caught the scent of iron from the dry blood on my hands. It was dated 3 years ago. Center frame was the curator. Slimmer back then. Alongside a blonde teenager in a tidy ponytail.
they were smiling. Another Polaroid unstuck itself from the wall as I pulled. Upon the white bar beneath the picture, there was some writing that was messily scribbled in vivid. Flytrap's birthday, dated a couple years prior. It depicted the curator and the girl, younger this time, beside our giant Venus flytrap we kept in the greenhouse. This photo had been taken at the museum while I was working. What is this place? Reaching all the way to the end of the wall, I picked up the earliest photograph. It was dated 15 years ago. The curator was sitting next to a hospital bed, the slimmest I had seen him, and with a full head of hair. Beneath the Polaroid, more writing, cancer-free. Right of the picture, on the bed beside the curator, was the same young girl. Maybe 5 or 6 years of age. She had bright blue eyes and... Sophia. The room was spinning. I felt like throwing up. This can't be happening. It wasn't happening. The curator was right. I was going mad. I'm going mad. I'm just going... Dad? Her words were quiet, distant and afraid. Her voice broke me in two. I turned. Those same eyes, that smile. My sweetheart was older. She was in her early 20s. After all, it had been 15 years since I last heard her voice. Sophia? The words trembled from my lips. For a while I cried as she hugged me. I thought about how the curator doctored the hospital's notice of death that I had received so many years ago. And I thought about how Sophia had been beneath my feet the entire time, caged like an animal, and enslaved as a future pawn for the rich and famous. But after some time, I only thought about her smile. And when she pulled away from me, her eyes caught the bits of a curator's skull upon my maroon waistcoat. We still got up. We had a lot to talk about. But after she had seen what was on my waistcoat, her smile had faded, and the sparkle in her eyes was long gone. Still bawling, she sat upon her bed. "Where have you been?" she asked. "Right here at the museum, honey. Once a week. The other days I spend off-site. Never far," I spoke. "They don't let me visit the museum on off days. They have lots of cleaning to do." She was choking up as she spoke. Her words took a while to come loose from her lips. "No, they don't," she sniffed. "Dad, the curator shows me and teaches me about the museum on those other 6 days." She pointed a shaky finger to the Polaroid pictures on her wall. "He says that I'm going to be a superstar tour guide, loving every moment of working here, just like you." I thought back to the golden placard on the wall. The next guide. I felt like my heart was going to give out. This world was cursed. It was cruel. "Honey, it doesn't matter what he said. He's a terrible man. He has been raising you to be..." I shut my eyes tightly, inhaling a deep breath. I didn't want to tell her who he was. I didn't want to tell her that her life was a lie, and her caregiver was a monster. "He's grooming you, darling. Like cattle for slaughter. You're gonna be a pawn for the rich and famous, just like me." She was shaking her head. "No," she sniffled. "That's not true. It's not." She bolted up from her bed and made for the door. "The curator is my friend. He wouldn't do that." I was shouting. "He's as bad as the rest, honey. Listen to me. They're all monsters. All of them.
all the rich and famous that visit this godforsaken horror house. There's no way she ever saw the rich people. She was hidden away through the door the nights I had given them tours. She didn't know where to begin when unraveling my incoherent rambling, and at that moment, she was just a sobbing mess. I went to hold her arm to settle her down, but she screamed, "Get off of me!" I felt hapless. "Listen to me, please," I said. "The rich are deplorable, and they are here once a week. You just don't see them because you're locked." She sprinted through the door. "Sophia!
Don't!"
Her slipper splashed as it met the maroon puddle of blood that pooled outside the doorway. She screamed and screamed, not only because she was beside the curator's face that had been mashed into a bloody pulp of broken bones and flesh by my hammer, but she might have screamed because at that moment, she knew her father was a monster. The words fell out of Sophia's trembling lips. You're a monster, Daddy. I went to grab her by the arm and hold her and tell her it was all right and that we were free. But she slapped my hand away and shrieked. My voice was quiet, pleading. "I'm not a monster, honey. I..." She was backing away from me. Pale moonlight flooded in and painted bloody steps upon the museum's marble floors where her slippers had been. Looking down at the ground, she didn't see the disgusting man lying there that had tormented me for 15 years, nor the man that had kidnapped and groomed her to be the next guide. All she saw, in the museum curator's lifeless body, were the remains of an honest man that had raised her in her father's stead. And I had just haphazardly scattered his brain across the marble floor with a hammer. She broke off into a sprint down the hallway, around the corner and down the steps she had walked many times before. I screamed after her and gave chase. When I finally saw her again, she had stopped in the middle of the foyer, a few steps from the door. Beelzebub and the Tooth Fairy were patrolling the halls, slowly making their way towards us. The museum's abominations did not wander aimlessly. They were searching for me. The museum was searching for me. It was not going to let me run free. The back of her blonde hair was facing me as she wrestled with the door locks. Sophia shrieked as I made my way past her and jammed my master key into the door and twisted. My heart was racing. The key that had worked for 15 years was not turning the lock. I kept twisting and turning my wrist, cussing as the museum's exhibitions loomed. It would never open, of course. Not this evening. Because something was amiss. The museum had no guide. Inside the foyer, Beelzebub fluttered a broken fly wing as it sucked his disgusting mouth tube in and out like a pacifier. When they would reach us, they would pull my teeth and flesh from my bones as easily as boiled meat. Sophia would be next. No, she was going to be free. The ground scratched as Beelzebub dragged one contorted spiny foot across the marble, closer and closer. And that's when I knew what to do. My arms were wide. "I will be resuming tours at 10 o'clock. Please leave your coats on the rack in the foyer," I said, my voice echoing through the museum. The sound of scraping and glass display smashing was no more. "Is that what you want to hear?" I screamed at the museum. Two horrifying exhibitions inside the foyer stood frozen. "Is that what you want to?" I trailed off, falling to my knees. Tears streamed down my cheeks and onto the ornate floor. The museum would have been satisfied with either me
or Sophia as the guide. But it was always meant to be me. Always. A clack chimed from the door behind me, and Sophia and I both turned. Snow drifted slowly to the ground through the large doorway outside the gardens. I managed to make out the gloss of the curator's black sedan underneath the piling snow, parked near the steps outside. "Do you see?" I said. I took Sophia's hand and held her cold grip tightly in mine. "The museum is cursed. The people that visited are cursed." Reaching forward, I braced her pale cheek with my other hand before she could squirm away. "Look at what I've become. Look at me." Staring into her, I saw my sweetheart, my world, my everything. Sophia was here, and she was real. She was alive. "Look at me, darling." Tears streamed down my face and met my shirt collar in blotches. "I may not be your father," I muttered. "Not to you, not anymore." I brushed her hair from her brow. "But I want you to know that I love you, Sophia." When her eyes met mine, I knew she hadn't seen her dad. She saw the museum. And I'm glad she did. Because if she hadn't, then she might have stayed. "I will always, always love you, my girl." I like to remember her smiling in that moment. But it may have been a trick of the mind. I let go of her hand, leaving the curator's car keys in her shaking palm. "You get in that car and you go," I said. She sniffled and nodded. "You go and go and don't stop until you are safe, honey." Johnny was right about finding freedom through the door. Though, it was never mine. The museum had possessed me, just as it had Mariette, and I could never leave. But Sophia could. "Goodbye, Dad." For the first time in years, my smile was warm and genuine. False memories of her future flashed through my eyes as I watched her breathe the cold air on the outside steps. I saw Sophia's first day at a real job. The smile on her face at her wedding. Her children starting school. My eyes followed her as she disappeared into the snowy evening in the curator's car. When I faced the museum, the exhibitions had wandered on, and the building was silent. And I put on a ballroom waltzing record before I began sweeping the glass of the museum's cold floors. The exhibitions were free, of course. But it was no secret as to how I survived 15 years of trauma. The museum had protected me from its exhibitions because I was her guide. As I made my way around the ground floor of the building, I noticed one glass display that had not broken in the chaotic evening. It was when I had passed the paranormal wing that I saw her. Her hand braced the window of her prison, and her fingers slid down with a screech. "Come on then, Mariette," I said as my key fit snugly inside the glass cabinet. The music from the record player was a divine tune of strings and soul, a song to dance to. I felt a spring in my step as the old tour guide, and I made our way to the main hall of the museum. The beautiful evening stars above the mosaic glass ceiling painted the marble foyer a beautiful azure. My grip made its way through Mariette's cold plastic fingers until we were holding hands under the night sky above. Her face was that of a shiny doll, but it did not matter. She still had a soul of the young woman that had once walked these halls and she was stunning. This evening was her time to feel young and alive again. Leading, I held her hand, and together, Mariette and I slow danced in the moonlight. Mariette, my daughter is free. Sophia is free. She's out there somewhere, starting a new life. The moon, the museum's marble, and my heart. The color of cold lips. The old guide and I waltzed left, then right. Isn't that lovely, Mariette? We twirled under the stars. Mariette?